PhET simulations can add a lot to a lecture by providing a powerful visual demonstration. However, to achieve even greater impact, you can add an interactive component to the demonstration through student questions and class discussion.
This expands, the temperature goes down.
Demonstrations are probably the easiest way to incorporate simulations into your classroom. Instead of putting up a PowerPoint slide that's static, bring up the simulation. It's the easiest way, I think, to just start adding that level of sophistication to your classroom.
Just the other day, I was talking about friction, and one of the PhET sims shows a physics book underneath a chemistry book, and you can see a zoom in on the interface where you can see the atoms, and you see the atoms jiggle more when you rub them together and they get hotter. So that sim is very simple. It doesn't have a lot of complicated graphics. It's just jiggling balls. But that's the message I want to get across, that high temperature means more atomic jiggling.
So if the students and I have the same visual model, then we can just have a much more productive conversation.
That was really helpful, actually showing it on the PhET so you can see how that affects it all, instead of them just being like, this is what happens, trust us.
Another way I use PhET sims is just in place of lecture demonstration, like a mass on a spring. It's just easier and more effective to go to the PhET sim because it's more visible. Also, I have total control of the physics in a PhET sim where I don't have that control in a real demonstration. I can slow down time so that things move slowly enough that I can point out the important features, or I can do things that I could never do in the real demo, like just change gravity.
We have a lot of demonstrations involving properties of gases. So within a PhET simulation, you have a great insight or a great tool to probe the why. See how they are striking the walls of the container, striking each other. How does changing the temperature affect the motion? So I find that that is a great way in an interactive demonstration mode to do the same kind of things that we already are doing, but now we have a tool that allows us to get to the answer, the explanation of why, in an entirely different way.
Here are some suggestions for making your lecture demonstrations more interactive.
The key is to get the students to be the center of the activity and not you. Like any lecture approach, you want to turn things over to the class as much as possible. You want to let the students ask the questions.
I try to make sure that I show something and then ask for their engagement. Lots of times I have a quick clicker questions, or I might do a wait time share pair.
Ask students what you should do to it. Ask students about what they predict is going to happen if you do something.
Do you think it would be harder or easier for the water molecules to jump up into the gas?
I'll ask the audience a question. I'm going to turn on friction now. What's going to happen to the total energy? Some of them will cry out, oh, total energy will go down because you'll lose energy to heat. And I go, oh, is energy not conserved when there's friction? And other people will say, oh, energy's always conserved, but you're losing it to heat, so where is it going? So I flip on the friction and they see the thermal energy bar start going up, and they see how the thermal energy bar is added to the potential and kinetic energies to keep the total energy constant. That sort of immediate visual is just so much more powerful than telling the students the answer or claiming that the answer can be seen from this formula.
The PhET helps kind of ingrain in our mind what is actually going to happen rather than like what we intuitively thought.
One way to accomplish this is by asking students to vote on the outcome of an experiment with PhET using a response system like clickers. Using clickers with PhET is covered in a separate video. Without clickers, an instructor can guide students through open-ended exploration and discussion.
The teacher can be the guide, and being the guide, the teacher can then input their parameters and see what happens. Ask them to predict first what's going to happen, what they expect to happen, observe it, and see what the result is. That is a really powerful way to learn. You learn what's important and what's not important.
I can ask students, for instance, how can I change the force of friction here? And then getting different student responses.
Can you think of any other ways in this to make it harder to push that fridge?
Increase the friction.
Increase the friction. How could I do that, Cameron?
So if a student says, well, maybe I could put one of these larger masses on the system, we can try it and then see, well, why did that make a difference?
It's one thing to see the professor
conduct an experiment or something. But it's a totally different thing to see the student generating questions that he has and that he wants to answer.
We'll often see students asking what if questions around the simulation.
One of the things that PhET allows that other things don't allow is when something spontaneously comes up in class, I can say, let's test it.
So what's nice about this is you can kind of go where the kids go. So let's see the sim, and they go, well, this is a solid. Now what's going to happen? What if we do this? And you can do that with a PhET.
So in that way, a simulation can really change the nature of a classroom. So you can engage in what I call whole class inquiry. In a laboratory, you might have two students engaged in inquiry with one experiment. But in a large lecture, you can now have the entire class engage in inquiry with a simulation.
As teachers, we love those spontaneous teaching moments that occur, and the sims really allow for those to happen. And you just have to, I think, open yourself up to that. Does anyone have any thoughts on that, why that might be? Yeah, JC?
If you tip the refrigerator over, would it have no friction?
That's a really good question. More surface area, does it have more friction? That's a good question, too. Let's all do an experiment.